surface stuff. He holds all things together. He don't just hold our marriages together and our homes together. He don't just help us keep a job and retire from it. He don't just help us get a car and a house. He holds all things together. Supernatural and natural. He holds all things together.
Yes,
sir. I'm making a case, y'all. I'm painting a picture.
Amen.
Do y'all see this picture I'm painting? The other was written by an unknown author to a Jewish believer audience and unbelieving audience. In Hebrews, go in there, chapter 1.
That's the one I like.
Right? I want y'all to see this. I'm making a case.
Yes, sir.
I'm making a case about he is not just a mere man. We shouldn't be treating him like he's just somebody that we can, you know, call on when we're in trouble and call on when we need help. But then, as soon as everything is good and hunky-dory and everything is going fine, we forget all about him. We don't even think to call on him, to thank him or nothing. We wait until we get in some trouble, and then we call on him. You shouldn't think about him like that, because he is no mere man. Hebrews chapter 1, y'all with me?
Yes, sir.
I know I'm moving kind of fast, but I ain't got time. I wish I could break this stuff down, and I wish I had time that I could really talk to y'all about these verses. But Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3 says this: in the past, God spoke. Remember, in John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And so when you go back to the origins of Genesis, in Genesis chapter 1, you don't have to go there, but it says, and God spoke, and everything became what it is. And watch this. It says, in the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times in various ways. Now he still speaks to us through different ways today. It says, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by his who?
Son.
By his Son.
Come on.
Jesus the Christ.
Yeah.
He's spoken to us, whom he appointed heir of all things. Oh. He gave him the inheritance of the earth. And so just because we think that Satan rules this planet, which he does, the world system, but he doesn't rule in creation. I want y'all to get that. Watch this. I just gave y'all something that was a revelation. No charge. It went right over your head. Satan rules in the world systems. That's why the world systems are evil. That's why we have all the killing, the fighting, the raping, the wars, all that stuff we see. That's why we have disasters, because this is a fallen earth. We're a sinful creature by nature. Okay, but guess what? He does not rule creation.
Amen.
Because God rules creation. This is still his plan. Amen. And guess who's going to inherit it when he comes back?
Jesus.
It's right here. Okay. All right, because y'all don't believe me. Let me finish reading, because y'all don't believe me. Here it is. He says, but in these last days, he has spoken to us through his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. Oh, my God. That's so deep. I wish I could spend some time there. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things. So listen, when you wonder about how you've been kept, I'm talking about how you've been protected.
Yes, sir.
I'm talking about ain't nobody breaking your house and trying to murder you. If you didn't get hit and get in a car accident and get killed. Nobody ran up on you and shot you and killed you. So guess who's protecting? Guess who's sustaining? Okay. Guess why you ain't lost your house, even though you might be back on your mortgage 6 months? The reason why, you because he's sustaining you. Guess who feeds you every day? Who's on the table? You go out and make groceries. But it's God that is sustaining you. Because if you didn't have the health and the strength in your body to even go out and sustain you.
Thank you.
And look, it's right here. He's the exact representation, which means he's a replica of God. He is the exact thing that God is, because he is God. Sustaining all things by his powerful word. I stop right there, because I don't need to go any further with that. Look, by his powerful word. So when he says something, something happens. That's why I tell y'all this. When you pray, learn to pray the word of God back to him. Learn how to read his word, study it, pull thoughts from it, and pray his word back to him. Because guess what? Isaiah 55 said, it will not come back to him void. Why? is because he said, when I send something, when he says something, he said, don't come back to me empty, don't come back to me void. He said, it accomplishes what I called it. I wish I had. But for some of y'all who worry a lot and who are anxiety and stressed out, I stopped by to give you this word today. Pray God his word back to him. Guess what? He's going to hold account to his own word. You can't miss.
Okay.
When you hear me pray, you hear me praying God's word back to him. You know why? Because I know he's going to honor his word, Cliff. I know he's going to honor what he said that he's going to do. It might not come when I want it to, but guess what? He's never late. He's always right on time. He always comes through just when you need it. He don't have to answer your prayers when you want him to answer your prayers. He answers your prayers when he feel like answering your prayers. Because he already know how much you can bear. Amen. And Bible clearly tells us that he is not going to let you bear no more than you can stand. Yeah. So he ain't going to let you go crazy and lose your mind. Yeah. That's why you don't need to be worried. Yeah. You need to start trusting and depending on the Lord. Yeah. You see, this is where we fail as a church. We don't trust him like we say we do. Because why? We just treat him like he's a mere man. I wish I had some brave people in here. We treat him like he's just one of us. He's not just one of us just because he was here in the flesh. He is God. And beside him, there is no other. All right, I'm almost finished. I'm making a point. Y'all get this picture? You see this picture, who he is? He ain't what you thought he was, did you? All right, he's somebody different now. He should be somebody different to you now. Watch this. Hebrews 1:1-3 offers us an overwhelming picture of the deity of Christ. Taken together, they leave no doubt that the man named Jesus, born of a virgin, was the incarnation word of God, and this is the worthy one that we should give our love and devotion to. You should love him just because. Amen. This morning, you heard me trying to pray? I just love him just because. It doesn't take music and singing, and it doesn't take worshiping and throwing up your hands and speaking in unknown tongues and all that kind of stuff to stir me up. I came in here ready to worship him before I left my house. I was already on my knees at 5:30, 6 o'clock this morning. I was already crying out to him. I was already calling on his name. I was already worshiping him. And so when I got here, I'm just coming out here just trying to share a little bit of what he gave me. Worship. This is why y'all shouldn't take him for granted, but some of us do. Some of us take him for granted. We don't need him till we get in trouble. We don't need him till somebody in our family get killed. That's what we call on him. You know, that's when lives matter. You know, it's a crazy thought, but you don't need him until your husband acts up on you, go out there and mess up on you, and sleeping with another woman and having 4 or 5 babies by another woman and bringing something home to you. That's when you call on them. Now you want to see them now. Now you need them now. Now you want to pray to them now because you don't know what to do. You've done all that you can do, but you just think he's a mere man. So I'm about to tell you that he is not just a mere man. He is God, and he is God all by himself. And you need to recognize that in the good time as well as in the bad time. Take him for granted. Call on him when you need him. Call on him anyway. Listen, some of y'all probably feel like, well, if I don't have to call on him, I don't need him for nothing. Why should I call on him? Just call on him. I call on him anyway. I was telling my wife and them last night, you know, this woman gave her testimony. We was at this place, we had a good time. And so the woman opened up and shared with us her testimony. And she shared it with us so good that I sit there at the table and I said, Lord have mercy, I feel like repenting and I don't even know what I'm repenting for. I'm talking about she had us in tears, man. We was like, I mean, because she just opened up and she said, is it safe for me to talk? And we said, yeah, ain't nobody here gonna judge you. And so she gave us her testimony, man. And that thing was heartbreaking because you don't know sometimes what people are going through because people won't share. You know, they think church folk will look at you and judge you a certain way, and some of them will. So she opened up and she told us, and I said, I got so convicted, I didn't even know what I wanted to repent for. I wanted to repent for something. I said, Lord, have mercy. I don't think I did anything wrong, but I feel like repenting.
Amen.
Amen. See, we take him for granted. We just think he's a person. He is a person. He is the second person of the Trinity, but he's God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You should treat him as such. Don't wait until you get in trouble to call on him. Call on him. Look, call on him and thank him for the good times. And thank him that he's giving you peace to go through this stuff. Thank him when you lose a loved one, that he's got you in your right mind. You ain't losing your mind behind you. Thank him for health in the body, health and strength. Thank him for the healing when you're sick and you don't know what to do. And the doctors tell you there ain't no hope for you. And thank him. Thank him when you don't know how you're going to pay your mortgage and how you're going to pay your bills. Thank him that he'll make a way out of no way, that he's a bridge over a troubled water. Thank him. And glory for who he is. He is God. He is no mere man.
Yes, sir.
I'm almost done now. I'm really serious, y'all. I got to get off this stage. I'm hot now. I'm about to burn up. Water all over the floor. I might slip and fall. Let me take my time as I coast on down. The Hebrew writer shows to us his preeminence over any Old Testament person or institution or ritual or sacrifice, that Jesus Christ was no mere man, but he was the Messiah. This was the climax of God's revelation. This is God's revelation to us, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus Christ is the full representation of the human experience and expression that God has given to us. He's superior to all, and he's exalted above anyone and everything. It is an irrefutable fact that Christ is no mere man. If you don't believe me, this is the last scripture I'm giving y'all from Philippians and the book of Acts. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 2. And here in verses 10 and 11, it says these words. It says these words. It says, well, let me go back to verse 9. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Look at that, y'all. It says that every knee, including Satan, including every demon, including every imp, including every Satan worshiper. Y'all know that Jay-Z worshiped Satan. Y'all listen to the music. Hey, Jay, I know that y'all young people, y'all millennials like Jay-Z and Beyonce and all them, they worship Lucifer. They're Luciferians. And they're not afraid to tell it. You know, they got this stuff posted all out there on the internet. All y'all got to do is pull up Luciferian. You'll see Bill Gates. You'll see some of the most wealthiest people on the planet. They're the people of power. They're called the Illuminati. They think they're running things. They think they got it going on. But here in my Bible, I don't know about in your Bible, but it says we serve a risen Savior, and he's going to bring the hammer. Great God, he's going to bring the hammer. Pow! He's going to crush. Y'all remember how y'all used to watch Batman, and y'all hear them words, whack, kapow, crash, crush, boom. Jesus is going to come back. Pow, whack, boom. On all those people who think that they are above him. Mm-hmm. Let's go to the book of Acts real quick, and I'm closing with this verse of scripture. In the book of Acts, chapter 4, I'm just making a case, y'all, and giving you a perspective. So what do you think about this Jesus, that he's no mere man? In Acts, chapter 4, hear these words. Verse 12, this one verse.
Yeah.
Verse 12 tells us, salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be what?
Saved.
There is no other name.
No other name.
There is nobody that you can go to. You can believe what you want to believe, but keep having birthdays. You go meet them for yourself. The judgment is coming.
Yes, it is.
And he's coming back as a king, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's coming back as a judge. And he's going to be bringing fire with him this time. Can you imagine those people that went through the floods out in Houston and out of Puerto Rico, and they're still trying to recover? They have not, you know, Puerto Rico is still in darkness. They're probably 7% darkness. Can you imagine after 2 or 3 weeks, your food is gone bad, so you can't keep no food nowhere unless you buy a cooler. See, y'all don't think about that kind of stuff because you got the nice homes. You got your electricity on it. You watch cable TV.
Yeah.
You go on your refrigerator, pull out a steak and cook it if you want to, and some potatoes and salad on the side.
Yeah.
These people are without lights, without power. Still, can you imagine the people in Houston? That's right, they preach. He's gonna be preaching. He's gonna be preaching, y'all. That's right. Can you imagine, though, the people in Houston are still digging out from the hurricane that hit them from over a month ago? They still have to rebuild their homes. They lost everything. Now, y'all can imagine it because you haven't lost nothing. But Jesus said that He is the name that is under heaven and above, that is name above all names, that you're going to have to come to Him for salvation. See, we don't think about that. We just think about the mundane, everyday stuff we go through. See, Noah and them didn't get it. Noah got it, and his people got it. But the people of the day didn't get it, and God gave them 120 years. Get ready to open up the doors of the church. He gave them 120 years to get the house in order. You remember this morning when I said Hezekiah was given the extra 15 years to get his house in order. Because the first thing the Lord told him was, you need to get your house in order. He was getting ready to take him up out of here, Colleen. He was going to take him on the door. Hezekiah prayed, cried out to God, turned his face to the wall. God, please give me 15 more years. Gave 15 more years. But Noah now was given 120 years. Can you imagine giving 120 years? If any of us in here live to be 120, we still wicked. We still serving Satan. After all God has done for us at 120. And so everybody perished. Everybody was consumed with water. Can you imagine this? And I know you can't. It rained for 40 days and 40 nights. It covered all the mountains that's on earth. Can you imagine that? It covered the mountains. It covered everything. Because God, He didn't destroy the ark because the ark represented His presence. The ark represented Him. And He kept Noah, his sons, and their wives, and their wives. But He destroyed the whole world. Now watch this. I'm saying that to say this is a get rid of codes. Get rid of open the doors of the church. This time He's bringing fire.
This time.
Y'all seen the fires out in California? Man, have you really seen the fires in California? Have you really seen the pictures of where the fires have come through and hauled out everything? Now, Troy is from Detroit, Motor City. My oldest brother worked for the Ford company for almost 35 years, built cars. Did y'all see the cars? They were burnt to a hole. Won't nothing there. I'm talking about AJ, everything was burnt. I'm talking about won't no seats there. I'm talking about it's just like somebody jacked the whole car. I'm talking about took everything off the car. It was burnt to nothing. It was just a hole sitting there. No homes, everything was burnt. They lost everything, the trees, everything, the land, it was burnt. They got a movie out called Brave. It's about these fires out in California. These guys are battling these fires. And one guy said, it's like being in hell. Now, I don't think he would have known what that is, but you in so much smoke, and you in so much fire, and it's so intense, and it's so hot, it probably felt like hell to him. But he survived and got out of it. Now, I'm stopping to tell y'all today that y'all can get out of it. It's God, but only by way of Jesus Christ, who is no mere man. The door of the church is open if you don't know Him personally. I just made a case and painted you a picture that He is the one and only true living Savior. If you don't know Him in your heart today, if you have not made your peace with Him and got your life right with God, you need to make your peace with Him on today. Because He's coming back.
Amen.
He's coming for you whether you believe it or not. He's coming back. He's coming. And He's coming in a flame. He's coming fanning fire. He's bringing fire this time.
Amen.
And it won't be by nuclear war. It won't be by man killing each other, destroying each other. Troy, it won't work like that, AJ. It won't be man destroying each other through nuclear war and bombs and stuff like that. So don't get it twisted. Don't even worry about that, because it won't happen like that. Humanity will not destroy it themselves. God will not allow it to happen. He said he's bringing the fire. Mm-hmm. He's going to bring the heat. Yeah. I alluded to this once before. This is how serious it is. Y'all remember the two angels? Y'all remember Sodom and Gomorrah? Mm-hmm. I believe them boys just sent two lightning bolts that blew those places off the planet.
Yep.
That's all they did. Boom. Mm-hmm. It sent lightning and blew Sodom and Gomorrah off the planet. It's still smoking today. It's written in the Bible. It's still smoking. Can't nothing live over there. Can't nothing grow there. Because it's still smoking. Why? Because God is still showing us an illustration of his wrath to come. Mm-hmm. He's showing us that I am God, and besides me, there is no other. Can't nothing habitate there. Can't nobody live there. Can't no plants, vegetation grow. Nothing. Because he destroyed it. And he meant what he said when he destroyed it.
Mm.
It was wicked. It was evil. If you don't know him in a part of your sins, you might want to do what I did last night. Mm. I just said, I just feel like repent.
Mm.
I don't know what for. But I need to repent.
Yes.
How awesome God is on the day. Do you know him today? Do you know him in the heart of your sins? Have you learned anything today? What do you think? What do you think? I want you to think about this as you go home today. What do you think? That he's no mere man. He's no mere man. This is the sovereign God of the universe. In the presence of his son. His son representing him here on earth as a human. It was God in the flesh. The word became flesh. And so let us bow our hearts to the throne of grace. Father in heaven, we love you, we bless you, we want to thank you for your word.
Yes.
The word incarnation. Jesus Christ will come in flesh and come to represent you, Father.
Mm.
Came to obey you, came to be faithful to you, and he did. And I want to thank you personally because of your saving grace. I want to thank you for your saving faith for everybody in this house on today. That, Lord, if they don't make their peace with you here and now, that they will go home to their proper causes and they will make their peace. Because I know the same thing that you told Hezekiah, you're telling all of us in here today, we need to get our house in order. Because we don't know the time or the hour. We don't know when we're leaving this place. But when we leave this place, I'd rather be absent from the body and be present with the Lord than to be damned to damnation. And for you to say to me, depart from me, I don't know you, I never knew you. And so, Lord, I want to thank you for your amazing grace, how sweet the sound. I want to thank you for your mercy, your new mercy today that's carrying us. Right now, as we speak, you're pouring out new mercies on us. Right now, thank you for your protection. Thank you for your sovereignty. Thank you for your providential care. Supplying all of our needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. We want to thank you, Lord. And after today, we will not treat you like a mere man. Because you are Lord. And you are God all by yourself. So we thank you, we bless you, we love you. It's in the precious name of your son, Jesus the Christ. Let everybody who loves him and agree say amen.
Amen.
Amen again.
Amen.
Grace, peace, and mercy be yours until we meet again. In Jesus' name. Hug somebody.